Good afternoon, Toastmasters. And guess, what is special about the year 2020?
It has 2020.
Great.
And you definitely. We used to have this year in our pledge.
It's a
10 late, years back.
Leap year. No,
okay. There, see, I got the answer that I wanted.
Yeah.
So it's the year N, where N modulus 4 equal to 0. And n modulus 100 not equal to 0 and n modulus 400 equal to 0. So it's the leap year. And
how is n modulus 400?
N modulus 400 equal to 0 and n modulus 100 is not equal to 0.
So n modulus 400 is not 0.
N modulus 400 equal to 0.
It
should be not equal to 0.
No. Years divisible by 100 are not leap years. Unless it is divisible by 400. Yes. So this might be one of our first C program that most of us would have written during our college time. Yeah. And Feb 29th is a leap day. I hope all of us have a memorable leap day this year. Yeah. And I think Julius Caesar is called the father of the leap day. He was the first to adapt leap day in 45 BC. Okay, as an essay, it's my duty to lay some ground rules that are to be followed during the meeting. I would call them the three M's. First M stands for mobiles. Please put your mobile phones in silent mode if you have not done yet. Take a moment to do it so now. Thank you. The second M stands for mannerism. So whoever... All the transitions on the stage between the speakers should happen with a handshake, and people should enter or exit the room only during an applause. During the last meeting, the applause was very weak, so I request people to give a wholehearted, strong applause. This is not a rule, this is just a request, so please do so. And the last M stands for matter. You can talk about anything except the taboo topics like sex, religion, and politics. Having said that, I would like to call upon the presiding officer, Toastmaster Abhijit.
Good afternoon, fellow Toastmasters.
Good afternoon.
Okay, well, some of you were busy inside talk, so maybe you didn't listen. But anyways, good afternoon, everybody, once again.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
All right. Federico Fellini said, different language is a different version of life. Thankfully, in Toastmasters, we have to only master one. Well, but that doesn't really stop us from trying to learn new languages and gaining new experiences. In today's Toastmasters meeting, we'll follow the usual steps. We have two speeches, we have a table topic session, and we'll follow that up with evaluations. But to start the proceedings, we always start by welcoming the guests. So we have two new guests here. Some of you might know them, some of you might not know them. So why don't you go ahead and let yourself introduce to the team and what brings you to Toastmasters, please share with us.
Hi guys, I'm Prashant and I'm from Xbox. I'm here for the last 2.5 years. I don't know who, like how many of you know me or how many of I have interacted with. Toastmasters, I'm not sure like how, what it deals with, or it's the first time I'm being introduced. So it's a new experience for me. Probably I will get to know some new things and new stuff from this session. Yeah.
Thank you. Round of applause for... All right. And we have some second guest. Something show up and you were asking if the time would be changed, and of course we couldn't do that, but this could be a demo meeting and introduction to Toastmasters. So because you're very new, I would like the Toastmaster of the day when he come here also explain what we do in these meetings. All right, without further ado, let me pass on the baton for the anchor for the day, the host for the show. Please welcome Toastmaster Pragnya as the TMOD for today.
language. A set of words, written or spoken, symbols that can be put together in various combinations to convey information. It is also that habit that we human beings, right from infancy, we pick it up by sheer observation, sheer reception, with no formal training whatsoever. It is that tool which can transfer the things that are swirling in this head, this lonely, isolated brain, in a series of combinations of incoherent sounds which are made to sound coherent by combining them, and transfer it to the minds of another person. Now, Hank Green says it's almost like telepathy, except there's an extra step of writing or reading. Now, any level of complexity can be expressed by language. I can very well say that when she shows you the red card, please stop speaking. It can be simple as that, or it could be, I don't know, explaining the string theory or the theory of relativity. Now, as we set the tone for this meeting, there are a lot of traction in the linguistics field, and I want to open with a thought experiment, which I did not design. It was designed by a philosopher by the name of Ludwig Wittgenstein. So he says in a room, the experiment begins like this. It's a thought experiment, it doesn't happen in real. There's a room, there are a set of people in that, and every person has a box. Inside that box is a thing. That thing is referred to as a beetle. It's not a beetle, it's not a real beetle, it's the reference to an object in a box. Now, I'm only allowed to look inside my box, I cannot look at the box of the person next to me. How will I know, and how will each person know, what is the content of that box? How can we convey the contents of the box? By means of language. So if we all can speak a common language, we can describe the attributes of that object. But can we truly tell the meaning of what is the object that resides in the box? Let's take a more realistic example. Close your eyes, sorry, you can keep it open. Imagine the color red. Okay, so what did you just imagine?
Red sheet.
Okay. So which shade of red? Crimson, cardinal, scarlet, sherry?
Wine.
Wine. Let's go for another example. How many of you like the smell of earth after rain? How do you describe the smell of rain? Fresh, natural, earthy,
wet mud.
Muddy. What about beyond that? How do you know that the smell of earth to you is the same as the smell of earth to the next person? How do you know the subjective experience of what you feel when you imagine, or when you think of the smell of mud or smell of earth is the same? We do have a language, but are we able to convey that? Now, we'll again revisit this theme. Again, we will try to scratch the surface of various concepts of language in terms of the opinions of the speakers who will take the stage today, and try to, you know, further understand linguistics. In brief, there will be three sections to this meeting. The first section will be prepared speeches. This is for the where two speakers will present their speeches on. It's a prepared speech. It is based on a particular level of the pathways that they take, which again we'll describe once the speaker comes on stage. This will be followed by an evaluation section where each of the speakers is given constructive feedback. The job of the evaluator is to observe every movement, every word of the speaker and give them constructive feedback. This will then be followed by a table topics session where a member from the audience is asked to come pick up a chair, give an impromptu speech. So guests are also involved in this. Right. The next speaker on the stage, who I'm going to call, is a polyglot. He can speak four languages. I asked him, is there any situation where you felt that the knowledge of one language was actually beneficial to you? And he said his knowledge of Telugu was extremely beneficial to him when he visited Tamil Nadu. So I believe it was the external languages are fairly less receptive there, and he believed that his language knowledge of Telugu helped more in Tamil Nadu despite not knowing Tamil. So to call on stage, we'll have the general evaluator, Toastmaster Vinash.
Dajia how? Guten Tag. Does anyone know this word?
Japanese.
Dajia Hao means in Mandarin Chinese, hello everyone. Guten Tag in German, good afternoon. So when I got to know about the theme, I just wanted to know what are the active languages in the world? How many languages would be there? We know only four, so someone can guess.
7,000?
Yeah, I think our team is prepared. So we have around 7,000 languages spoke. And which is a language which is spoken by most of the people?
Mandarin.
And in Chinese. I think I should tell, I should have asked you to keep quiet. let the guest. So, yeah. So, the instant I spoke, right, the language is important. I was supposed to be Tamil Nadu. I had to move from here to Salem, and then from Salem to the final destination. What happened is, there was no bus from Salem. I don't know Tamil. I knew other languages. And by Tamil Nadu, maybe we can relate to Akshaya. They are very much... I asked a person in the station, I have to actually change the bus. I don't know. I have to go to some other place, and from there I have to move to some other place. Mm-hmm. I asked him in English. He told, I don't know English in English. Then I didn't know whether should I continue the conversation or should I go back. Luckily, I had software engineers like me traveling from Bangalore to their place. So they helped me finally. So, do you know ethnologue? You don't answer, please. Because, have you heard about ethnologue?
No.
Ethnologue is a publication which is Languages of the World. From that, that will actually, every year they're going to research, they'll find out what are the languages that are actively used around the world, and they're going to publish. So coming to evaluation, for a moment I was thinking, what if we had schools which won't evaluate us? Our education system which doesn't give grade. For a moment I was very happy. But later I got to know that without evaluation, maybe I wouldn't know how to speak in English. I wouldn't have learned languages perfectly. So that's the reason. Today my role is something similar to that. I'd be the general evaluator of the meeting. So I'll be taking note of entire proceedings, starting from the way it began until it ends. I'll give the feedback at the end, my evaluation. It will be constructive feedback. And I have a tag team, to help me out in evaluating three aspects for the speakers. Timing, then the up counter, followed by grammar. So I would like to introduce the timer of the day, Fatima.
Informal conversation with anyone, whom the first question would be, oh, your good name, Fatima. Oh, and then they start in Hindi. Then so many times I've confessed to many people, I don't know Hindi. How come your name is Fatima? You should know Urdu. I thought that I should. I'm from Tamil Nadu. Oh, I got it. So this is something which always struck me when I hear about the language. And one other language which is approved or which is not protested, at least in my school, is English. We can master in it. Having said that, today I'm taking up the role of a timer. We have a couple of speeches, L1, P2 and P3. So the duration would be 5 to 7 minutes. I'll be showing green, amber and red at 5, 6 and 7 minutes respectively. And for the table topics, it's 1, 1 and a half and 2, green, amber and red. You can correlate it. And that's all. Thank you.
Our counter for the day, Rohit.
Thank you, GE Avinash. So, hi guys, I'm Rohit. I'm going to keep a tab. I'm the R counter for the day, and I'm going to keep a tab on the R's and M's used by. I have used like quite a few. So I'm going to keep a tab on R's and M's used by the speakers here. Also, I will be keeping a tab on the filler words. Filler words are like and, so, you know, which we use to connect the sentences where we should not use these words. And also, I will be keeping a tab on the word repetitions. Repetition. Thank you. Thank you.
Grammarian of the day, Rahul. Sorry, Bhargav.
Good afternoon, fellow Toastmasters. I am the grammarian for the day. As a grammarian, my job is to look out for wrong usage of grammar in your speeches. Some of the wrong usage of grammar. Improper usage of tenses. I will eat fish for dinner and drank milk. What is wrong with the sentence? One is past, the other is present. I will eat fish for dinner and drink milk. Or I ate fish for dinner and drank milk. Anything might be correct. Anything is correct. Subject verb agreement. We enjoy horror movies. What's wrong with this?
We enjoy
the horror movies. pronoun errors. I fed all the fish and cleaned its tank. What's wrong with this sentence? I fed all the fish and cleaned their tank. You're referring to the fish, right? And double negatives. Yeah, this I find very annoying. I won't do nothing. What's wrong with this sentence? I won't do nothing. I want to convey I don't want to do anything. I say I won't do nothing. That's wrong, right? It's I will do nothing. Or I won't do anything. Just make it simple. And as we speak about language, one common error we as non-native speakers of English make is language translational errors. So what language translational errors means is, say you, as a non-native speaker, you kind of think in your mother tongue, and then while speaking out, you try to translate it and then speak out, right? So, as an example, मुझे वो बहुत पसंद आई. मुझे वो बहुत ज्यादा पसंद आई. If you literally convert it into English, I very much like her. It's not actually I very much like her, it is I like her very much. So these kind of errors. And I'll also, you know, point out mispronunciations. And I would look out for the usage of the word of the day. The word of the day is intangible. Intangible means unable to be touched, not having any physical presence. So something which you can't physically quantify, right? So one example is, the athlete owed his success not only to strength and speed, but also to intangibles such as perseverance and dedication. And in the sense of, in the corporate world, you could use intangible as. For a company, intangible assets such as customer goodwill are hard to build up. So that's it.
End of the meeting, we'll present our feedback. So we have one more room here. So Shreya.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
How many of you have watched the video sent by Rohit today? How many of you have seen that there was an email by Rohit today sent on Toastmasters? Okay, and how many of you have clicked on it and seen that there was a video link and clicked on that link and then watched that video? Okay, please, please do go watch it. You will know what I'm doing here based on that. It's really funny. You will actually see tangible results. Did I use that right?
Yeah, but you have to use it in tangible.
Right. I don't know. Maybe you could use the antonym also. But anyway, so you will see tangible results of people having improved from the beginning till now. So that's the point of this video. I'm doing this today so that tomorrow you can see yourself and feel better as to where you've come from. Thank you.
How many of you can speak a language other than English and your mother tongue? Okay. How many of you can speak a foreign language, a non-Indian language?
English.
English. Excluding English. Okay, so how many of you have moved to a different city or town for education, work? How many of you can converse in the local language of that place?
Can manage.
How many of you use your mother tongue, feel that English overtakes your mother tongue when it comes to expressing most of your day, the majority of your day? How many of you feel that a swear word used in your mother tongue is more impactful? Kali given in your language.
For me, it's Hindi.
Effective. Yeah. Drives the message home. Okay. So, I'm a proud Kannadiga. What does it mean? Why am I proud to speak a language? Is it because it's several years old, or is it tied to a cultural heritage? What aspect of me, what aspect of the language is a part of my personality? The next speaker who had to come on stage had expressed, was asked this question that, do you believe any language, especially your mother tongue, is an aspect of your personality, even if a small one? Or do you think your opinions or viewpoints are totally independent of what languages you speak to convey them? And that speaker had expressed that she believes that the language has She believes language has a key role in developing aspects of personality because it is easy to understand the intention and body expressions and in general the thinking of the speaker if they speak in their mother tongue. their personality is shown more when they're comfortable in the language they speak. Now that person backed out, but even then, we have another person from her team, and when I asked about a memorable incident, because they work in TAC, they interact with customers across the world, she gave a memorable incident, which I think is inclusive to the team of TAC, not just her. I'll just narrate that. So they had a Spanish-speaking customer call in, and he started speaking with the first hello. The only thing they could understand was arista and issue. The team said, we don't understand you, and asked to wait till they got the translator services. They did manage to get a Spanish translator in 30 minutes, and when they asked the translator to describe the problem that they were facing, he's looking for some property listings around downtown San Francisco. And so he called arista, and he's facing issues in getting quotations for the same. Lost and found in translation. I now invite Toastmaster Jayendra, who will be the evaluator number one for him.
Thank you, Toastmaster Pragya. I'm trying to connect with the team and to the people. It's been quite some time since I took the stage, honestly. So, language is definitely an art of expression. When we try to express a lot of things, people perceive a number of things about us. So, everything that we build is a result of our own language, be it in terms of our social circle, be it our friends, the people around us, be it the customer. Every relationship is built around language. Whatever language we speak, be it English, Tamil, or Telugu, or Urdu, we still try to build that kind of relationship. And hence, language is an integral part of everyone, not just me, everybody in this room. With that, I'm not going to bore more about language. I'm going to be evaluating Hind. I take pride in evaluating Hind because he was the evaluation contest winner. And now I'm going to be evaluating him. So this is going to be his L1 P2 speech 2, where he has already given one speech in the form of a story. And there have been some feedback that has been given already. And today's speech, we'll be looking primarily for gestures, vocal variety, and the storytelling, the flow of the story, and the amount of eye contact as well. Back to the Toastmaster. Okay.
When we think of an idea, does it come as a non-verbal idea, and then we find a name to give it in a language we are comfortable with? Or is thought born in language? Can I not conceive anything without language? The same Ludwig Wittgenstein that we spoke about at the beginning of the meeting says, the limits of my language is the limits of my world. When this question was posed to Toastmaster Hind, because I find that his philosophical take on most of his speeches, I thought it would be an apt question. Do you think language is a limitation to your understanding? He concurs. He says that without Hindi or English, which is the mediums that he speaks in, he would not be able to channelize his thoughts. When he cannot formulate the thought because there is an expression for language, it is beyond his fathoming. I would like to call Toastmaster Hind for his L1 P3 speech in Under Persuasive of Influence. Don't look under, Toastmaster Hind. Toastmaster Hind, don't look under.
I'm not entirely sure why my titles generate laughs. I don't intend them to. The girl on the third floor, there were still laughs. Don't look under, there are still laughs. I don't intend them. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
Thank you. Karan woke up with the screams of pain ringing in his ear. He wiped the sweat off of his face, drank some water. His breathing had become faster. A quiver ran through his body. The nightmares were refusing to leave him. He took a deep breath and looked at the little mound under the sheets on the other corner of the bed. He pulled at the sheets to make sure that his son was sleeping well. He leaned in to kiss his son's forehead and then started his day. Amit, waited until he heard the closing of the bathroom door to open his eyes. He tossed in his bed to face the other way from the bathroom door. He didn't want his father to know that he was awake. He didn't want his father to know that he had been awake for a couple of hours. He waited until the clock shrieked 7 a.m. and then he started his day. It had been 3 years since that fateful day when Karan lost his wife and Amit lost his mother. Nobody in the house had slept well, ate well, or even lived well ever since. Karan would try to keep a happy face around Amit, but every resting moment, every quiet second, he would miss, he would remember Kalpana and he would miss Ashi. Kalpana didn't like that Karan had named their unborn child without knowing whether it was a boy or a girl. Why do you get to decide the name? Okay, then tell me what is the name? What have you thought of? When the time comes, you'll know. But the time didn't come. The time never came. Amit would try to make sure that his father believed that he was doing well. It helped that his grades were good. It helped that he was participating in extracurricular activities in the school. But it was hard. No, it was impossible to not miss the lullabies at night. He had not heard a more sweet voice than that of his mother. Karan and Amit progressed with their day. The usual day trundled forward, and the two struggling souls, they danced to the beats of the schedule. The schedule, Karan and Amit would wake up, get ready, the cook would prepare breakfast for them before they became ready for office and school. Karan would pack Amit's tiffin, Amit would polish Karan's shoes, Karan would drop Amit at school, Lakshmi, their household, and Amit's nanny would pick Amit from the school and take him home. Lakshmi would cook dinner for them, Amit would take tuition for math and guitar, Karan would come home at 8 p.m., they will have dinner, they will take a stroll around the apartment complex, and they would finish some chores and sleep right at 11:30 p.m. The schedule was good. The schedule helped them. The schedule helped them not think much. Because thinking much brought back memories, and memories were haunting. Schedule progressed, days and months passed, but one day was different. One day, things changed. Karan woke up at the sound of the alarm at 7 a.m. He was calm, if not happy, knowing that he didn't have nightmares. He turned to wake up Amit, but got shocked. Amit was not there on the bed. Karan panicked and jumped out of bed. His panic was immediately diffused when he saw Amit sitting at the window staring outside. Karan went to him, asked, "What's wrong?" Amit said, "Nothing, I just woke up early." The day progressed. Karan dropped Amit at the school. Throughout the way, Amit was silent. He didn't speak anything. When on normal days, he would describe the things going on at his school. Karan again inquired. And Amit said, no, everything is all right. It's normal. Karan went on with his day. In the evening, Karan received a call from Lakshmi. "Bhaiya, Amit is not here. Autowalas are saying that he just walked by himself." Karan panicked again. He jumped. He didn't know what to do. He ran to the parking lot. It was only seconds after he got out of the parking lot that he received another call from Lakshmi saying, "Bhaiya, Amit call aya. Amit has reached home. I'm going there now." It was very unusual. But Karan brushed his thoughts aside, went on with his day. Karan reached home late at night, and when he was entering the apartment complex, Lakshmi was leaving. He stopped her in her tracks, and asked about Amit. She said it was mostly fine. Amit was in his room taking math and guitar tuition. I sat with him in the bedroom. We watched some TV. Karan entered the home, called Amit out. They had dinner. Karan insisted on him to sit with him as he worked. It was around 11 when Karan asked Amit, Beta, will you have some milk? Amit said no. Karan said, Beta, you go, I'll join you in 10 minutes. Amit went. 10 minutes turned to half an hour because Karan again got hooked onto his laptop. Half an hour later, Karan switched off the hall lights and proceeded towards the bedroom door. The bedroom door was half shut and the night lights were on. As he approached the door, he heard sounds of sobbing coming from the room. He opened the door and he saw Amit squatting in the middle of the bed and sobbing. Karan couldn't understand anything. He asked, Beta, what happened? Papa, please go away, Papa. But Beta, what happened? Papa, please don't come near, Papa. There's a ghost. By that time, Karan had already gone near the bed. And Karan says, Beta, there are no things called ghosts. Don't be afraid. Papa, please go away, Papa. There's a ghost under the bed. Papa, please go away. Beta, here, I'll check for you. There is nobody under the bed. Papa, please don't look under. Here, Beta, there's nobody. There are no ghosts. He squatted. He crouched. Karan crouched to assure his son that there was nothing under the bed. He looked. He froze. And he fell to the floor. As the face of his son looked back at him from under the bed and said, Papa, there's a ghost over the bed. Thank you.
Thank you, Toastmaster Hemant. The characters, Karan, Amit, Kalpana, the ghost, Lakshmi the maid, all figments in his mind, their emotions, their pain, their longing, conveyed to us in front of our eyes by sheer language. So let's do a translate, time for translations. I'm going to say a sentence, an expression, and we'll figure out if there's a word for that in any language that you or that you know of. Leaving the book unread after buying it and just letting it pile up with the other unread lonely books in your house, possibly the meanest thing you could do to something as valuable as a book. Any word? Okay, take a guess. So the Japanese have a word for it. It's called sundoku. The next. If you've ever been talking to someone you've been introduced to before, but their name has completely disappeared from your brain, then what would you call that? Deja was more of a recollection. It's like a repetition of what happened. This is like I met a person. A week later, I know them. I know their face. I know what they spoke about. I just don't know it. I forgot their name. It's just gone. So the Scottish have a word for it. It's called tartle. Tartle. I don't know how you spell it, but it's spelled as T-A-R-T-L-E. That feeling you get of homesickness for a place you've never ever been to. Of course, there's wanderlust, but there's longing to go to a place. This is homesickness for a place you haven't visited. The Germans have a word for it. It's called Fernweh. Fernweh. F-E-R-N-W-E-H. Of course, my diction might be wrong. You get the message. So a single idea, a single expression could not be translated by a single word in two different languages. Now, when this question was posed to our next speaker on stage, that when literary works, when books are translated, can the translated work in the new language express the author's intent exactly as it did in the source language? So our next speaker has had the opportunity to read some great works in Tamil and some English novels by Indian authors. And he thinks that translated work does not reflect the author's image. He has quite an amusing example to drive the message home. His stress buster is watching Harry Potter in Tamil. Avada Kedavra. Everyone, I guess, most of you know what that does. Kill the person in front of you. So when translated from English to Tamil, the death curse is translated to as please die. It is a humble plea of death. Please join me in welcoming Toastmaster Sasti, who will be evaluated too for Abhijeet's speech.
So language. Language is an emotion. I think that whenever I call the hotel server, Tamil Nadu hotel server in Bangalore, Anna, I get an extra D in my dosa. And my friend who sits nearby gets a dry dosa. When it comes to translation, I have a strong belief that the author's image is not at all reflected in the translated work. I'll tell you an example of how difficult translation can be. When I was in my 10th standard, my Tamil teacher asked me, what is your duty to your mother? Well, as every 10th standard kid heard respond, I said, to take an empty tiffin box to my home. And she again asked, what is your duty to your father? I said, to attend the school without barking it. She was like, Maramanda, Maramanda. It means like empty-headed person. Then she said, she gave me two brief explanations, or rather very elaborate explanations, which I didn't understand then. She said, a duty of a son to his mother is to make her hear that she is such a great son. She said, when a mother hears that your kid is such a great kid, she'll be more than happy when she gave birth to you. And the duty of a son to his father is to make him hear that, oh, what great deeds has this person done to get such a son in this life? Do you know in how many words these great theories or philosophies has been expressed in? How many words?
7.
Exactly. This was just expressed in 7 words. It's called Thirukkural. He said of duty of a son to his mother in 7 words. A duty of a son to his father in 7 words. I don't think any translation could express with such a depth of thought, and it could make such a deep impact in you. That said, today I'll be evaluating Abhijeet's L1P2 speech. A speech is always that makes the listener listen with full attention and is the one that is completely understood, is what I believe. That's what I'll also be looking for.
Toastmaster Sasti told, there are 2 aspects of language, the speaker language and the audience language, and only when they're equated does it make sense, because what is the intent of the speaker has actually been conveyed to the audience. There's a linguistic professor called Noam Chomsky. Has anyone heard of this? He's a 92-year-old. He's been doing this work for quite a long time. Now, what we believe is that language is something that is acquired by reinforcement. In a household, you know, you watch your mother, you watch your parents, you watch your siblings. But what Chomsky proposes is that humans as species are genetically predisposed to acquire language when compared to others. There is a predisposition for grasping grammatical rules. And he says that this is aided by the fact and also encouraged that every language in this world, irrespective of how weird, different, foreign it may sound to you, has some basic structure. It has verbs, nouns, adjectives. So when every language has the same structure, where does the question of is a language superior than another language? Is the mastery in one language superior to mastery in another language? And does mastery in one language even help you in a specific situation? This question was posed to our next speaker, who spent quite a lot of his time outside India, that whether mastery of a language, say English, could propel his achievements in a country that is foreign to India, which in this case could be United States. And he says that it's, I'm phrasing it, that within a society as we know it, we are drawn towards, feel comfortable with, and are influenced by the similarities that we see in one another. Moreover, we get inspired by finesse one exhibits in this common interest. Mastery in a common language can play both of these roles. So yes, he agrees that mastery of a language can propel one's accomplishment, not only in a specific setting and in general as well. The next speaker, Toastmaster Abhijit Kaul, is delivering his L1 P2 speech, an innovative planning pathway. Something that doesn't kill you only makes you stronger, Toastmaster Abhijit. Toastmaster Abhijit, something that doesn't kill you only makes you stronger.
A husband and a wife were forced into a precautionary quarantine at home. After a week, the husband hurriedly picks up the phone, dials the number of his best friend and says, "Hello, hey, I don't know about this coronavirus and all, but if I spend one more day with my wife, either I'm going to kill her or she is going to kill me way before this virus does anything to us." Good afternoon, fellow Toastmasters. For so many years now, I've had three main questions. First, when will Achhe Din come? Second, when will this Donald Trump get impeached? And third, when will I win a single argument against my wife? Thankfully, I know that I am not alone in this very, very tough time for survival of today's married men. Believe me, I've heard tragic stories of my friends being locked out of their houses. Some had to find shelter under the bed to protect themselves after the fight with their better halves. Well, before I delve any deeper into this obviously very, very sensitive topic, let me put out a disclaimer. The thoughts and opinions expressed in this speech are factual, very objective, and generally unpopular with most women. Well, for a long, long time, when me and my friends met with each other for solidarity meetings in a number of bars, the common question that came up was, why do we argue so much more than our parents ever did? So we thought, it's a predicament, right? I mean, we definitely are doing more of that. What could be the reason? So we came up with a few things that probably could explain. First, the fact that we the sons saw our fathers being showered with so much adulation and reverence and respect when we were growing up, let's say, gave some false expectations. To make matters worse, we were never forewarned that these, our dads, are the last species of males who are going to get that treatment from their wives. I think at this, combining these two things, the very life's foundation of we the men today was already compromised. But let me assure you, I'm not a non-feminist at all. In fact, I feel amazing that after generations and generations and generations of struggle, finally the daughters today are treated just like the sons. My sister was equally not allowed to indulge in any household chores while growing up as I was. It's my mistake that I thought, this is how my whole of life will look like. I will have to do just nothing. When in reality, my share of cooking, cleaning, was just deferred to until I get married. Well, why I'm talking about household chores at this point? I think 9 out of 10 fights between couples happen over household chores. Isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Well, for some people who didn't really say anything and are married, let me ask you, have you ever fought with your spouse over things like, honey, I don't agree with you. I definitely think Israel should pull out of West Bank. Have you ever had that kind of fight with your wife? So the most fights happen over household chores, right? At this point of time, some of the women in the audience might ask me, well, yeah, you the intelligent man. And we can all empathize that you were dealt with the wrong card of fate. You were born in the wrong generation, and probably, and you had your tiny little expectations crushed. So what? You claim you're so intelligent, right? Why don't you do the obvious thing? Just adapt. Let me tell you, that's what we are doing. Every single day we are trying. But tell me, what would you do when the argument takes this kind of turns? From, honey, can you help load this dishwasher? Sure. To, why are you so slow in everything, including loading a dishwasher? And to finally, can you please come here? Do you know there is an angle at which a glass needs to be put in the dishwasher and at a certain place for optimum cleaning? I think at this point in my married life, I decided my fate was sealed. Well, I used to think about so many useless subjects that we used to read in school, but the use case of geometry would be in loading a dishwasher is something that I could have never ever thought about. Well, let me assure you, and to be very clear, I really, really love my wife. And I'm not saying this because I'm being video recorded. In fact, I really feel proud of the fact that she is very independent, empowered, and a very intelligent person. It's just that sometimes I feel and I wish I could just evaluate and give her feedback on her part of the argument. Well, maybe in my dreams, but if I were to do that, well, I think I would have a lot to say. But if there was one thing that I could tell her, I would say, honey, the diatribe that you just gave me, I think it was very effective. I got the central idea, trust me. But I think I want to give you some suggestions for improvement so that you can use it in our next fight. Well, first of all, please be on the topic. I admit my mistake, I really do. I did miss putting the diaper in our daughter's bag today. But what has that to do with something I did in 2014? Can you please be on the topic? Because otherwise I lose track and I just don't know where you're going with that. Remember, your supporting argument should always justify your title. So please, next time we are in a fight, make sure you do that. Jokes apart, it would be a huge injustice if I don't say that I learned a lot from my wife. She definitely taught me how to be more philanthropic. She taught me how to put others before you put yourself. And finally, she also taught me how good I am at sitting and doing nothing. Anybody heard of the nothing box theory? Okay, maybe that's for another speech. But yeah, I think that's something that I'm best at. But I can definitely claim I'm a much better version of myself, a better husband, and a better father, thanks to the rigorous training that I've got from my wife. In the end, I would like to say that a deadly combination of false expectations and growing up with that expectations and just the inability to understand an over-evolved and over-complicated species called women have led us men to our nadir. So if you are one of those 99.99% of the men out there and you've had this argument with your wife and you think, what should I do? I have an advice for you. Just take a deep breath and listen. Because sometimes she might just be right. And for all other times when you were right and you've been proven wrong yet again, remember, some things that don't kill you make you stronger.
It was relatable because I've seen this in between my parents. And when I was younger, I would take my father's side because you would always see your mother telling the truth which hurts. And now I'm old enough to know that my father was wrong anyway. So. Well, as they say, familiarity breeds contempt, perhaps. But not so in chest. Okay. Coming back to the beetle in a box. So what did we derive out of it? About subjective experiences. Even though an experience is exclusive to one, it may not be expressed in a language that is exclusive to that person. So in conclusion, what we mean to say is we may go through our entire lives not knowing exactly how another person feels, how they perceive the world, how their sense of smells, how they perceive a thing of beauty, how they experience pain, how they experience joy, how they experience heartbreak. Well, one of the theories of this was this, is that
though language is something that unites us, finds a common cause, it is very much possible that me and the next person are going through the exact same experience, or we can be going through something that is starkly different. Moving on to the next segment, how many of you have heard about the Berklee School of Music? It's one of the largest schools of contemporary music in the world. There is an Indian ensemble in the Berklee School of Music, and I believe in 2014 they did a concert which was in association with A.R. Rahman, a medley of songs which is there on YouTube, with a 16-part series on YouTube, where they could be immersing themselves in the soulful tunes of Tere Bina or jamming to Hamma, or swept away by patriotism in Rang De Basanti or Vande Mataram. It was a scintillating performance just to watch it on YouTube. I mean, I can only imagine how it might have felt when you were in that hall. Now, what fascinated me was not that people there were singing both Tamil and Hindi songs. We know singers in India who have sung in, I don't know, a dozen languages. It kind of comes naturally to us. But what was fascinating was that the members of the Indian ensemble come from 42 different countries. Just by the look of faces, you can say there were Middle East people from the Middle East, people from Southeast Asia, people from Europe, people of African American origin. And the fact that they were able to embrace a language, lyrics, instruments that was completely foreign to them and yet immerse themselves in that was telling. Now, does music have language? Does anyone think that music and language are intertwined? Has anyone heard Hans Zimmer? Interstellar, I mean, anyone about the background score of Interstellar, of Inception, is there any language there? Just a bunch of instruments. But you feel it speaks to you. Let's take the Interstellar docking scene. The song is No Time for Caution, no lyrics. And yet you're able to the moment you can hear the music, you can visualize that scene. So the question that we posed to our next speaker was, do you associate music with language? Is it important for you to understand and connect to the lyrics of the song in order to enjoy it? And she concurs, yes, it is important for her to really feel what the lyrics conveys, for her to have a good experience with the song. And sometimes she's worried about being irrelevant in this pop Punjabi driven music era. So please join me in inviting Toastmaster Srileka, who will be the table topics master for the day.
Quite a few struggles with multiple languages. With my mother tongue Telugu, I did not have to struggle. But with English, I had to struggle. Why did I learn English in the first place? Because of the prejudice that the society had. Like, people who can speak English can do anything. Because of that, I had to learn English. And later, after joining engineering, I learned Hindi. That is because of the indirectly felt peer pressure. And after entering Arista, because of my extremely lovely colleagues and friends and their great affinity towards their mother tongue, I had to understand most of the Tamil. And now, because of my mom's pressure that I have been living in Bangalore for around 5 years, I am trying to learn a little bit of Kannada. So that is my journey with languages so far, and I hope I'll do better. Coming to the table topic session. So whenever table topics is said, there are certain intangibles in your mind, right? Hesitation, reluctance, fear, what not. But luckily, I'm on the other side today. So I get to pull you people, leaving with no choice, like I was left today, to take up this role. Okay? So the format of today's table topic session is going to be a little different. It is impromptu, but you don't get the choice to pick up the chips. So because there is a plot line around which the table topic session is going to revolve, the plot line is someone's iPhone 11 Pro got stolen. Okay, so there is a reason behind why you don't have the choice to pick the topic you can talk about, that you'll get to know at the end of the table topics. So there is a sequence that you have to follow, and there's a small catch as well. You have to intend to listen to every table topic speaker to be able to speak when your turn comes. Okay, so who is ready to take the plunge? Okay. As expected, it is.
Table topics.
Okay, maybe Arjun, can you volunteer?
Walking past Raksha once. I was walking past her desk because she had some doubts regarding something, regarding some VLAN connection. And when I saw there was a tab for an iPhone 11 on Amazon open. And I'm pretty sure she was not planning to add to her cart because it was very, very expensive. And myself who has bought it an EMI can tell you that it is very expensive. Believe me, I have not yet finished paying the installments for it. And I'm really, really sad that I have lost the iPhone 11. So, Akshya, let me tell you one thing. Your phone looks really decent over there. I don't think you need an iPhone 11. Do you?
Should I come?
It was just a rhetorical question, Akshya. Well, you'll get a chance to speak in your defense. But that was just a rhetorical question. Your Android phone looks pretty good. I just bought an iPhone 11 for the iPhone 11 experience. So why not get an iPhone later on? Why steal mine? Thank you.
So as Arjun decided to blame Akshya and accuse her of this, let's welcome Akshya to listen to her.
Yourself in the court trial.
So basically, there's a word called khulasa in Hindi. So now I want to endless certain facts about Mr. Toastmaster Arjun. So right from day one, Mr. Arjun has been bit let's say apprehensive or kind of not comfortable with the fact that I joined 1 week before him, and he thinks that I made a crore in this 1 week that I joined before him. That for anything I try, Akshya, you joined 1 week before me, right? That's why. So, for somebody who's just waiting for a chance to just bring out that 1 week which I joined before him, I still want to know how a person can make great numbers in this 1 week. I mean, okay. And coming to the next fact, that my phone is good. I have been having that phone for the past 5 years of my life. It's the first phone that I ever bought. And I still, because I have a lot of personal sentiments with the thing that I own, that it's almost impossible for me to even buy something which is beyond what I have. Basically, I am a Sindhi disguised in a Tamil body. So, if you want to sell me anything beyond 10k, or if you want to extract 10 rupees from my pocket, you would have to argue with me for an entire day. I will not even give you 1 rupee, because I need justification for why I should give you that 1 rupee. And also, I am so conscious about what I spend that I will take 1 minute to Google Pay even 1 rupee if I borrow that from you. And imagine me buying an iPhone. I mean, I am okay to go without a phone for years and years together, but I would definitely not buy an iPhone, and that too on his office laptop. Even if you are selling me iPhone for 100 rupees, I will think, okay, this is 100 rupees. So that is my defense as to Akshya is Sindhi. So please think a minute before blaming anything costly on her. Thank you. Thank you, Akshya. So we have heard the owner's argument and the accused's argument. So let's have another exciting role in the discussion. Who would like to volunteer?
Thank you.
iPhone owner. Do you recall any incidents to support the owner's blame? Basically, you have to suffer. Okay. So, there was one fine day when Arjun came and he was so excited in office. He was jumping around. He was literally hopping from one place to another, going everywhere. I got a new phone. And the kind of poor folks that we are, we realize we will never. I'm also, I can say, a Sindhi, I guess, in some ways. I would never, ever buy an iPhone in my life. So I thought, let's just enjoy it for a minute, you know. But maybe someone else had more dire plans. Not just enjoy it for a minute, but enjoy it for a lifetime. Since, like Akshaya said, we don't buy things, we just try to get them. I could understand maybe to some extent her mentality of wanting one without the expense, added expense to it. Also, I was passing by and then I also saw her eyeing that same phone that I had already checked. Because as I said, he was running all around the office going, I have a new phone. I saw her eyeing it. So maybe it could be possible that with the circumstantial evidence of her having opened an iPhone tab on her laptop, it means she has to be the one who stole it. Thank you.
Person, do you have something to counter back the owner's blame? Okay. The person Arjun is, I'm pretty sure that he would never buy an iPhone. So the whole nearby bullshit he has explained us, he must have stolen it from someone. And by some way, he knew that the person whom he stole it from has an insurance for that iPhone. So now what he wants to do is... Oh, sorry. This is a wrong argument. Forget about insurance. Okay. So, yeah, as I said, he would never buy an iPhone. So... he always wanted to, you know, accuse Akshaya because she was Sindhi. He didn't like Sindhi people. He wanted to excuse her of being miserly and, you know, and all. So that's why I think he's pulling her legs. He always pulled Akshaya's leg. I would think that he wants one more iPhone. So he just kept iPhone. He has just hidden the iPhone somewhere and then he wants to claim the insurance and get the iPhone again. So he wants to have two iPhones for himself, so might be that.
So the serious court trial has taken an unpredicted turn, so we are pressed on time. So these are the table topic speakers for the day. So please, this is the link. You can go here and vote for the best table topic speaker. So we'll have 1 minute. The link is working, right? Are you fine? So it is bit.ly/best-tts. TTS is in capital. Even the guest can vote. It's open to all five stuff.
what's the definition of a game now that we just had a game of blames, accusations, defense? So what is a game?
Set of activity, define the rules when one will win and one will lose.
Okay, so that's it. So let's say it's a contest, say, between two parties, when one wins, the other loses. And it's in sports. What if it's Game of Thrones, where you win or you die? Is that a game? Or what about that game when your mom is angry with your dad and starts thrashing you indirectly? Who's winning there? Guilty until proven innocent. So let's play a small game here. I'm going to say a statement in a language that is foreign. Most of you might have heard it somewhere. You want to guess which. So first is, it's going to sound like gibberish, but it could be familiar gibberish. Fire pisenge luk sani, fitopi oil, sipyang fte, tinenong, livelu, ailalu. The meaning is, these demons are forbidden here. I will kill this one as a lesson to the others.
This is a game?
No, yeah. That's, you should guess which is the language.
It's
this is a game.
Philippine or something like that?
Thai.
Thai or Philippine.
Okay.
Somewhere in the southeast.
So it's the language Navi from the movie Avatar.
So
okay. This one must be familiar. Hashe, Dotre, Chek, Ashe. How are you today? Do you ride well today?
Dothraki.
Exactly. Game of Thrones, a song of ice and fire. Next. Nukdak o puchpe. Where's the bathroom? Okay, Star Trek fans. Star Trek fans.
Klingon.
Yeah, it's Klingon. Okay. So the last one, which is, it feels nice for this meeting. Elixila lumen omen tiyulo. A star shines on the hour of our meeting.
Lord of the Rings something?
It's Elvish from Lord of the Rings. So J.R.R. Tolkien was a lexicologist. So there's an entire science. If you a lot of Game of Thrones fans, I guess, but people watch the behind the scenes of. There was a time when I would even watch that. There's one person who designs these languages. All the when she goes all the languages of Meereen, the Dothraki, like the Seven. I believe the White Walkers also have a strange language of their own. But yeah, so what is meaning exactly? So who defines meaning? And who gets to decide that this means, this custom means this, right? So at the end of the day, meaning is use. So if all of us decide to call this as, I don't know, bang bang or anything of that sort, and all of us concur that we're going to call this duster the same for many years to come, it's as well as having given it a new meaning. And that's the message of this made up languages. Now, we will begin the evaluation section. I would like to call the Toastmaster Avinash, who will be the chief, and to kickstart the evaluation section.
After the fun-filled table topics, I don't want to get into evaluation. Maybe table, you can continue the theme. Judgment would have been better.
So we'll start the evaluation. We'll go with the first speech evaluation. I am called Jayendran.
Congratulations, Sint, on completing your level 1 V2 speech 2. Some of the positives about Sint's speech today is the start. The way in which he started with, on a touching note, about the family, about Karan, Amit, and his wife. Sorry, I forgot the name of her.
Kalpana.
So, the start was really exceptional, where you managed to capture all the audience attention with a bit of an emotion. The other good aspects of your speech was tone. You were able to modulate really well when you were giving the speech. For example, the role plays that you did. It was moving across one place to another, and then changing the tone with which you are trying to express certain things. That was also very well received. The pace was well set throughout the entire story. It started off well. The story itself had a good start, and the time where it found the end was also very visible. So it was clear As in, at no point we felt that, okay, where are we actually heading? Or when is the story going to end? So that pace was really well set. Although there was a situation as to how is it that it's going to end, that was, that's a different part. But from the start till the end, we managed to see that the pace was really maintained very well. And one of the feedbacks that we got from the previous thing is the amount of eye contact that you were trying to make. This time, there was no issue with the eye contact. It was pretty evident that you managed to catch everyone's attention, and you were also like keeping in contact with all the audience that was sitting there. A simple language, especially when it comes to storytelling, you need to ensure that everyone is able to understand the story that is being told. So it's good that you picked up a simplicity in the language that you have chosen. There are a few things which I wanted to talk about. Before that, I have one question to the audience. So there was a time when Hind was actually narrating about how a day goes by for Karan and Amit, starting from the morning till the night, and they all come to bed. At what time of the night did they retire?
11:30.
Great, that's good to hear. So one of the things which I wanted to say is, especially when you are doing a lot of sequences, right? You are pacing your speech up to ensure that you are connecting all the events together. At places, if you can insert the time so that people can also try to connect and say, for example, somewhere after 2-3 events at 12 o'clock he did this, at 3 o'clock he did this. So that would give a better picture as to which part of the day and what is it that you are referring to. So some places I missed as to where exactly or what is it that they are doing. That's the only thing that I thought I would suggest. Rest, it was a great speech. And for the future, if you want to challenge yourself, it's going to be the vocal variety where you can try and improve a bit more of complex words into your speech and make it more attractive to the audience. Thank you so much and congratulations once again.
Now, second speech evaluation, first.
Second speech, the speech began with a very interesting statement. I always believe that it's just not the first appearance or the thought you strike. It's always, again, the first statement which you make in your speech that attracts your audience. It was humorous, and everyone's attention just shifted right to you. I didn't flinch an eye in the entire speech, and I was just listening completely. It was a speech filled with humor in every sense, and you didn't miss any chance to fill this room with laughter. There were different tones used in different parts of the narration that was really well, and the gestures were very appropriately used. You even took a moment to smile or laugh in between your speech. That combined with the gestures makes the audience feel that whatever is being spoken is legitimate and truthful. As humans, we always tend to find truth in everything, and we tend to connect to something truthful, and which is always humorous, and confessions is always something we like to hear. I still believe that your story is fictional though. Well, in this completely very good speech, there was just some misusage of words here and there. For example, you said, next time when we are in a fight, and you suggested something, it's next time when you are in a fight.
You would be able to finish it on time, at least for the first time.
I think Timon's role is excusable. That can never be changed, I guess. So now we'll go to the, I'll call Rohit to give the opportunity.
Guys, what a wonderful meeting. Let's give a round of applause to all of us. I can really see an improvement in ours, filler words, word repetition. Few people whom I would like to mention about. Evaluator to Suspeak. What an awesome job. during your introduction, the number of the nouns were
zero.
The number of filler words were
zero.
And the repetitions were
zero.
So what a great job. During your evaluation, I had my fingers crossed that you will not use any of those, but you used only one R. So awesome job. And evaluator J, again on the same lines. During your introduction, you just used one filler word. You didn't use any R's, ums, and you had no word repetitions. Again, during your while giving your evaluation, you again used just one filler word. So total count is 2. What an awesome job! I think I will run out of time if I like. But let's do it, because today's meeting quality was very good and I got to learn a lot. Videographer, again, you just used one filler word, so very good job there. Now coming to speaker one hint. Again, I mean, you are a role model for the whole team, but let other fellow Toastmasters guess. How many other nouns did Hind use?
4.
0.
How many filler words did he use during his speech?
0.
0.
0. Okay, how many word repetitions did he use?
Please let it not be 0 again.
2.
Yeah. Oh, you are keeping a tab.
No,
I remember one. And the other one is a guess.
So, great job, Hin. Again, Abhijit, very good job. You used just one R, 2 filler words, and 3 word repetitions. That word repetition, I think, came at the end of your speech. But again, awesome job. So, again, a round of applause to both our speakers. I will just quickly mention timer, just one and one filler word. Grammarian, one count and 2 filler words. Table topic master, your R's and ums were 3 and filler words 2. Now let's go to some of the other roles. SAA, you use 4 R's, ums, so I think that probably you can work upon. I don't know whether you were nervous or like what was the reason, but I'm still okay, but maybe one thing to work upon. You just use one filler word, no word repetition. GE, again, I can see lot of improvement in you. Again, a round of applause for the GE. You have a lot of credibility, but you only used 4 R's and ums and 2 filler words. Okay, so good job there. Coming to TMOD.
In a dozen languages, with a very interesting line,
So what do you think the best part of today's meeting was? There was one thing that was filled throughout the meeting.
Humor.
Listen, I think this is, I don't remember any other meeting that was this humorous. Well, maybe that's one good thing, you have to learn with humor is very good. I'll start with a couple of good points. You know, we started 5 minutes late, I think that will be by default. Anyways, though we have to improve on that point. Attendance was a bit weak. We went at the last moment. Maybe we can start 10 minutes before pulling the people in. Anyways, if you're deciding to pull in, they should start. That's one part we can improve on. Guests were welcome. That's one thing. And guests were introduced about the theme, about the meeting by Toastmasters. Team mod was interactive and a lot of information we got about language. I think we have to go back and look into the video and try to understand, because it had different sections. Thanks for such overwhelming information. One next thing is few handshakes were missed. Maybe I think this is again started back. Again, we should check that part. The roles explanation, I think Grammarian explained the role better when I compared whatever meetings I've attended. I think this time the Bhargav, the way he explained the grammar of his role, I think that was the best thing. So far, and yeah, as a general evaluator, I missed videographer role. Next time, the role shall not be missed. Best thing, two of the speeches were good. And table topics, I think this is one of the best interesting thing. Thanks for selecting it, and it was so engaging that people were interested too. I think almost every one of us involved. It was not only the speaker. Thanks. I think yes, that's it.
Thanks
for the time.
Okay.
So to work with the best speaker and evaluator, please go to the link tiny.cc/bestoitc. O is capital.
What is the verdict? I mean, they should get.
I had off. The judge role, but then we were pressed on time.
I
made a point.
Everyone is able to put in their vote?
No.
Selection?
I don't think I will.
Not opening for you?
No. And I have only 2% charge. So.
Me too. Whisper your choices in the ear.
So who do you think won the best table topics?
How many?
iPhone for 500 rupees. You can take.
Trivia. The last thing I would do is urge everyone to watch this TED talk called How Language Shapes the Way We Think by Professor Lera Boroditsky. So I'll give an example. Okay. Please pretend that it was accidental. I know it looked deliberate the way I dropped it. So if assuming it looked accidental, how would you as English speakers define this event? Just the action, not the, you know, not the metaphorical as such. What did I just do? So I dropped the pen holder. So let's assume it broke. For an English speaker, the action, the focus is more on the doer. So Pragnya broke the vase. Pragnya broke the glass. English is such a language where even the accident, the person says, I broke my arm. Nobody goes to deliberately break their arm, but that's how the language is constructed. But for any other language, this is not the case. If anything happened accidentally, it says, the vase broke itself, the vase broke. This example is given for Spanish. So what's the implication in the same event of me dropping something and it breaking, an English speaker and a Spanish speaker, what implications do you think it has?
We are more likely to accuse.
Blame and punishment. So an English speaker would be first to say, Pragnya, you broke it. But a Spanish speaker would say, it was an accident, it fell. Where in the real world do you think it will have?
Judicial.
Exactly. So if you're testifying for a crime, for the same crime, two speakers with two languages, how their perspective changes, how they view this event. So the moral of that talk, which I am reiterating here, is language does shape the way we think. And what is important for us to take home is, why do we think the way we do? Is it because of language, or you know, there's something of our own added there? Is there any way that I can think differently? And what are the new thoughts that I can create? With this, I would like to call the presiding officer for the day, Ms. Mastaraji.
Well, enough has been said about the nature of the meeting today. Everybody laughed a lot. I think we all enjoyed. I think it was all great. And it's not really that bad. We're just around 20 minutes late. So I really appreciate the fact that many of us just love to talk. Well, but I think then all of us who are already there in the first step will have to then think about mastering the most important aspect, which is
valuing everybody's time.
Valuing everybody's time is definitely one thing. Although I could be mistaken, but I could sense that everybody was just enjoying. Not could be the case every time, right? But most importantly, the skill that I'm talking about is really defined in these simple quotes. Simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. If you have too many things to talk about, just think about whether you really need to talk about in so many words. So I think that's one thing that we need to really think about, think hard when we are preparing content. And secondly, if you are not able to still converge it, I think we have to be blatant to ourselves and we have to cut it short. There is no other way we can really finish on time. So please make sure that we do that moving forward. I had some things to talk about, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to finish, wrap up by asking our guests. First of all, before you speak, eyes on that side, and everybody's going to tell me what's the name of today's guest.
Prashant.
Yeah, you already read. But all right, Prashant, you had some feedback for how do you felt the session was? Anything good?
I think it was a wonderful session. So it was a great 1 hour time we spent today. And moreover, the overall context was about humor. So whenever you have humor in something, it tends to engage people more. So if you have to say a serious thing in a humorous way, I think people get to catch it very well. So you can convey many things in a humorous way than in a serious note. So that's what I felt today. So about your speech, a wife and a husband fight is never kind of fictitious. It is always. So otherwise, yeah, it was a great time. Thanks.
Okay. Well, we look forward to have you back here for future meetings. Soumya, any feedback from your end?
Yeah, it was really wonderful 1 hour session. I really could not get like what every week happens. Like, do you have a different theme every week, or how does every speaker speak on like different topics? Mm-hmm. But otherwise, it was really good, and it was really like good benefit. Whatever I had thought, it was really helpful.
Okay, great. Round of applause for both the guests. Well, I would still take 20 seconds to let you know what we do here every week. The theme could change. That's entirely up to the Toastmaster of the day, who's kind of the host and drives the show. But the core idea is very simple. Everybody here wants to be in an environment where they can improve on their communication skills without being intimidated, without being pressured, without being having to do that as a part of their main job and some, you know, performance, performance implications around it. So that's the main idea. And how we do it, you probably now can connect the dots. We have a prepared speech which focuses on how you can really prepare well and give a great presentation. It could be a talk or anything, right? The second part is the impromptu speech. Well, you could be suddenly told to share your ideas just like we did here. All of us at all times can do much better than we have been doing in that moment. So that's the idea. That's something that is hardest to master, but I guess requires the most practice. So the good thing is that you don't need preparation. You just come here, you get thrown under the bus, and you try to, you know, stay alive by saying something. The last thing is evaluation. Every now and then, we directly or indirectly, we are telling somebody how things went, how you did something, how you did, how we can do this thing better, how we can interview better, how can we, you know, give this, do this thing better. So we are kind of evaluating. But are we using the right points? But more importantly, are we using the right verbiage? And are we effective in really drawing the point home? So that's kind of the three main things that how the Toastmaster meeting will be every week. The theme will change. The roles will remain the same. How we deliver will change. So that's kind of the main thing. Hopefully you get the idea.
Yeah.
And feel free to join more meetings. We would have actually loved if you would have come over here to speak on a table topic. We generally tend to, you know, push our guests that way, and many of them end up winning the best over table topic. Well, that just has been the way. The best first time speaker ends up winning it. But so maybe next time. We meet at the same time and the same location. We generally try to finish by 4:15, 4:20, and I think we went way over. We're going to try to do that, honestly, moving forward. All right? And by the way, feel free to talk to Rohit, who is our PP membership, or Hind, and we have like 7 officers who are kind of trying to plan things and maintain the club proceedings. So if you have any more questions, then all of us kind of sit here. Thanks for coming. Well, again, wonderful meeting. Let's again meet next week. Please volunteer for roles. I'm not going to take the volunteers now, and we are again going to get into session of not me, he or she. So let's do that offline. So please volunteer for roles. All right. Have a good rest of the week. See you next week.